I came to opera at that time because my mother introduced opera to me. My grandmother, on her side, on the Portuguese side of my family, loved to sing and had always wanted to be a singer. But her father, so my great-grandfather, actually forbid it. He didn't allow her to pursue anything in the arts because he thought of the artistic world for a woman, just not what good girls would do. My mother, when she saw that I was so interested in singing in general, because I was constantly singing around the house, and she could hear that I actually had a nice voice, she thought, well, I'll give her that opportunity since my mother never had the opportunity. The moment I started studying opera, actually at 10, it felt so natural and it felt comfortable. Whereas if I had been pursuing Broadway or pop, it just didn't feel as good, it didn't feel as satisfying. And when I watched my first opera, which was Bohème, this is the Zeffirelli production from the Met with Teresa Estradas and Jose Carreras, I absolutely knew at that age I had to be an opera singer. I had to do what these people were making me feel. Chose every single track in the album to fit the message that I wanted the overall thing to be, which was about immigration and acceptance of all people from all walks of life, and even about my own background, being a daughter of an immigrant, my mother who's Portuguese, where all of these, let's say, Villa Lobo songs that I do, that's where it's coming from. Yes, I am an American, but also I have a European background, which, let's all face it, is American. We're all in the United States, immigrants in some way. And the No Word From Tom, being from Stravinsky, he was also sort of an immigrant coming to the States. I think that's quite special because there is some music that exists that are really gifts in the repertoire and should be treasured along with the other, let's say, repertoire that's a bit more popular. Right now, in America, there is a little bit of this, well, not a little bit, there's a lot, of this feeling of separation between certain parties, certain races, and it's creating a very negative, I think, impact on the rest of the world. And because America is so, it's such a big focus in the world, I feel like this really needs to change. And I don't think I'm the only one. And I thought when I was first concocting this album, my debut album, I did think, well, what do I want to do? Do I want to make an album sort of just about myself as an artist and what I've already achieved and record things that I know I can sing really well, and that's the album? Or do I want to use a debut album as a way to send a message, to have a bigger picture, not just to look pretty on a cover? And the message that I wanted to send was, yes, there's a place for us. We can generate a complete opposite message of positivity, unification, acceptance of all people, no matter what race, no matter what sexuality you prefer, no matter what religion, no matter what anything. because groups of people, mass amounts of people, are so much more effective and powerful than one.
Clear that the choices for what we're recording came from things that Nadine really loves. And there's something very special about that. And I love that she loves so many different things because there's a wonderful array and variety of styles and periods. And it makes a wonderful mix of things that it's clear she really loves.
I will say about Maestro Spano, I had not worked with him before, actually. He was somebody that I had known about, of course, because the industry is very small. And I knew that he was sort of a specialist in American music, especially American opera. So this for me was quite important because since the album is, I would say, mostly comprised of American music, collaborating with him was completely organic and natural, honestly a pleasure, even though it was my first recording.
For me, this was a great thrill because I didn't know Nadine before. And we actually met on Skype. I heard her sing, of course, and fell in love. But then to talk to her and then meeting her, she's everything her voice says she is. So this has been a thrilling experience to get to know her. What's wonderful about recording with the Royal Philharmonic with Nadine is that they are so sensitive and engaged and they listen so carefully to her and they adjust what they're doing with their ears and their musical sensitivity. So it's a particular thrill to have musicians who are so invested in a process that can be very challenging and very difficult. One of the most remarkable things about the Stravinsky aria from The Rake's Progress, No Word from Tom, is how his spiky Apollinean language becomes so touching and so heartfelt somehow. For me, that's always very special about this particular aria, where the humanity of his music is somehow very powerful behind this veneer of classicism and control. The Bacchianas Brasileiras, this tune has become so famous, and I think cellists really love to play this. So there's something wonderful about the marriage of the voice and the vocal quality of the cello and having eight of them that makes just a magical quality for this piece. To me, there's no question that Nadine has something special. It's not just that the voice is beautiful. It's not just that the musicianship is so well founded. It's not just her charisma, which is in evidence the minute you meet her. But all those things together, it's an embarrassment of riches.
I'm of that generation where social media was created, and I feel like it's been such a nice tool to use for my own artistic career, because it gives me, I think, a bit more direct communication with the people who are interested in opera and classical music. And in a way, it's nice to see the younger generation so interested in it as well. I want opera and classical music in general to continue throughout the years and inspire other people as it inspired me when I was 6 years old, to start even being an artist and being a singer. And I guess if I can somehow create that inspiration for another person watching me through social media, then I feel like I've done my job. Because my job at the end of the day, yes, is to perform and to be a singer and to be the best singer that I possibly can be. But really what I really want to achieve is giving some of my artistic love and aspirations to another person so they can carry what I think is a gift onwards. Audience members actually tell me their own experiences from watching opera for the first time and hearing opera for the first time live. This makes a very big difference. One question I get is, well, are you using a microphone? You must be. And every time I tell them, no, it's totally unamplificated. This is just us. It's our raw voice. They can't believe it. They can't believe that a human being can create that amount of sound to go over the orchestra and still be heard. I had one woman tell me, I can't believe I've wasted so many years of my life without seeing an opera. Because I know that if I had, it would have enriched many moments of my life had I seen it regularly. And she said that she would constantly go to the opera because of that one moment. And that's all it takes, really. I finished the first performance, the premiere, of Staatsoper Berlin's Falstaff, their new production of Falstaff. And it was also my debut as Nanetta. And also it was Barenboim's debut conducting Falstaff, which was very cool and very interesting. It was just a great success. It's very fun. It's very playful. And I really enjoyed making my debut here. I don't just consider myself an opera singer. I really consider myself just person, me. So my daily life is very normal. The best advice I ever got from somebody in the industry was Marilyn Horne when I was very young. I was 18 years old and I was having a conversation with her about competitions, auditions, being young, wanting to pursue the career, and how I should go about doing that. And she said to me, and I carry it with me until this day, she said, don't ever have any expectations of anything. Just enjoy the moment of performing, of singing, because the main goal should never really be just about yourself. It's about serving something, serving the art form, therefore giving it to the audience, and that should be the most pleasurable part of it altogether.